Right, welcome everyone to Medical Tutor. Today I'm going to be talking about, or I'm going to be solving some questions with us, in particular most important questions and most often repeated questions in JAMB. Now, I'm not saying the same questions are going to be brought out in your exam, but similar questions to them on the same topic are always brought out every year, and it will be very good if you can also search on the topics of each questions so that you can find the questions that can be related to them on your own. But today, this is what we are going to be dealing with. Okay, before we do that, I want you to click on the subscribe channel and put on the notification bell so as to receive more videos on this. Thanks for doing that. And I believe you've watched our previous video on how to pass JAMB and the things and reasons why students fail JAMB. If you haven't, please go back and watch that before coming back here. Okay, all right, let's start. Now, the first question here says, the most important hormone that induces the ripening of fruit is dash. The most important hormone that induces the ripening of fruit is dash. Now, if you are wondering why we are doing this, is so that we can explain the reasons why this A is answer, why this B is answer, why C is answer, why D is answer to you, so that we can interact with each other. So I want you to pay your full attention to these explanations. Now, here we are being asked about the most important hormone that induces the ripening of fruit. If you've ever wondered, you notice that sometimes your cashew that was still maybe green a day ago, you just notice that in the next 3 days, the cashew is already turning red. If you notice your orange, different fruits as well, they begin to turn or change in color, they begin to ripen. Now, there's an acid or hormone that controls this. Now, there are almost 5 basic hormones in plants. We have the cytokines, we have the ethylene, we have the acetic acid, we have the gibberellin. Now, and we have the auxin. That is one of the most important. If you've read about hormones of plants, auxin, cytokine, acetic, ethylene, and gibberellin. Note those 5 plant hormones. They might ask you in the exam one and say, which of the following is not a plant hormone? And I repeat it again. Cytokine, acetic, ethylene, gibberellin, and auxin. So if you're looking for the spelling of auxin, this is it. Auxin. So, all right. Then question here is what? Which one is important for ripening on fruit? The first answer here is cytokine, which is wrong. If you have read about plant hormone before, you know that cytokine does not involve itself in full ripening of fruit. So wrong. Acetic acid also we can't pick Indo acetic acid. No. Our fourth option here says gibberellin. No. What about the auxin I mentioned the other time? That's also not the answer. The correct answer here is ethylene. In fact, among the 5 major plant hormones, the one responsible for ripening of fruit, every fruit that is ethylene. The only one responsible for ripening of fruit particularly is ethylene. It does not have any other function. The rest might be doing part of ripening or whatever. However, this ethylene does not have any other function except from ripening of fruit. Do we understand? Now, talking about the other plant hormones like auxin. Auxin can help in elongations. You understand, elongations and growth. But I would like you to read on these topics on your own in particular. So if there's anything you want us to know, use the comment section. We are going to make a video on plant hormones if the need be. But just know that the answer is ethylene, and the only plant hormone that is involved in ripening of fruit is ethylene. This question is often asked at least 2-3 years in JAMB. So it's important for you to keep the answer in your head, ethylene. So let's move on to the second one. Okay. The question here says, the opening of the stomata. Talking about the stomata, I believe you know what stomata means, right? The opening of the stomata is controlled by, let's start from the last option here. The last option here says presence of a pore. Now, when talking about a stomata, on its own is a pore in the plant. Okay, have you ever wondered the way water leaves your body? If you are under a sun, or maybe you are in a heat, you're in a place where the temperature is very high. Do you understand? You notice that water is beginning to come out of your body. That's what they call sweating. Now, this water, as they pass through a particular pore, now in our own body, the pore does not really have a big name or anything. For at your level right now, it does not really have a big name. Maybe when you start studying, for those who are doing medical sciences, okay, you begin to get some explanations of follicles, on sebaceous gland, etc. However, at this stage, there's no really named pore for it, but there's a pore. When talking about a pore means a hole, a passage through which water or anything can leave through. So now, stomata itself is a pore. I'm talking about a stomata itself is a pore. So when we are saying the opening of a stomata is controlled by dash, so we are automatically saying the opening of a pore is controlled by a pore. That is wrong, because stomata on its own is a pore. So the question here is, what controls the opening? So the answer is wrong. Presence of a pore, no. Let's check the second one. Increase in solute concentration in the GAD cells. Okay, they said increase in solute concentration in the GAD cells. And the other one here says decrease in solute concentration in the GAD cells. Whereas the first one says presence of GAD cells. So there's another important thing you have to know about GAD cells in general. GAD cells are found around the stomata pores. Well, let me say around the stomata, because stomata are pores. And these cells help to control the opening and closing of the stomata. However, the question here says that the opening of the stomata, or let me complete the statement, the opening of the stomata is controlled by, they didn't say the opening and closing of the stomata. If they had asked for the opening and closing of stomata, we would have just picked the first option, which is A. Now, don't make this mistake in exam. The questions are always very tricky this way. So if they say the opening and closing of stomata is controlled by dash, it will be GAD cells, because GAD cells are the cells that control the opening and closing of stomata in general. But they said just the opening. So presence of GAD cells can also cause the closing, but they're asking for just the opening. And the second option here says decrease in solute concentrations in the GAD cells. No. Now, the reason why this answer is no is because if you've ever done what they call osmosis, osmosis is, for example, a situation whereby I have much water but lesser solute concentration. You have more and little water but much solute concentration. If two of us are to be placed beside each other, because your own solute concentration is higher than mine, you will tend to absorb all the water I have in me to your own self until we are both equally balanced. Now, if you decrease the solute in the GAD cells, they can't absorb water from the external environment or the internal environment or anything. And if there's no much water in them, there's no way they can expand. The more they expand, the more they are able to open the stomata. Do you understand the concept? GAD cells can only open if they themselves expand. They can only open the stomata if they themselves, they become turgid. To become turgid means to be filled with water completely. The inner and the outer forces are the same thing. So if the GAD cells are not expanded, then the stomata can't be opened. So which means the answer B is also wrong. But yeah, they say increase in the solute concentration in the GAD cells, which is correct. The reason why this is correct is because by increasing the solution in the solute concentration in the GAD cells are going to be able to absorb more water. And by absorbing more water, they'll become turgid and expand. And once they expand, what will open to the stomata, like I said, the stomata is going to also open up. So there's another question we can ask from this place. Look at this. I said the opening is controlled by what? Increase in solute concentration. Then what is going to control the closing? I want us to think about the answer on your own. If the increase in solute concentration of the GAD cells will open the stomata, then what is going to close the stomata? What is going to control the closing of the stomata? So put your answer in the comment section and we'll judge if it is correct or not. Don't worry, you can miss it, you can do anything. It's just for learning. All right, let's move on to the next one. All right, let's move on to question number 3. The question here says, yarn is used in osmosis setup because, talking about yarn issue in Yoruba, yarn is used in osmosis setup because, now in our secondary school, I don't know what kind of experiments we did, but I could remember then in my own secondary school, we used yarn, a beaker, solution, and salt. Okay, I think, yeah, salt. Now look at this diagram correctly. There is a beaker. That's the surrounding cylindrical button here. That's a beaker. We also have a V-shaped structure inside the beaker. This V-shaped structure is the yarn. And you notice one thing, there's a kind of solution in the yarn, and there's a solution also in the beaker. I repeat, this is a beaker, this is the yarn, the V-shaped one. So there's a solution inside the yarn, and there's also a solution inside the beaker. Now, the difference between the two solutions inside the yarn and the beaker is this. The beaker solution does not have any salt. No, it has salt in it. Whereas the water, the solution inside the yarn does not have any salt. I repeat, the solution inside the yarn is just water. There's no external solute or anything. It is just water. Whereas the water or the solution inside the beaker contains salt. So now if I'm to ask you, between the solution inside the beaker, which has salt, and the solution inside the yarn, which does not have any solute, which one do you think would be more concentrated in terms of solute? What would be your answer? obviously it will be the beaker, because the beaker has salt solution, which makes it more concentrated than the yam here, because it does not have any salt or water or whatever. Now, according to the rule of osmosis, what will happen to the water flow? Will water flow from the beaker, which is highly concentrated, to the yam, or water will flow from the yam, which is less concentrated, to the beaker? Obviously, you already know the answer. Water will move from the region of higher solute concentration to the region of lower solute concentration. So water is going to be leaving the yam to the region where there is no much water to fill it up. So eventually you notice that the water in this beaker is going to increase gradually. Okay, let me repeat myself again. Because the beaker solution is concentrated in terms of solute, it will tend to exert a kind of force on the water here. It will try to be drawing the water out completely. And eventually the water in this yam is going to reduce until the solution of this beaker reaches equilibrium. So which means water is moving from the yam to the beaker. But that's not the question, but that's a general question on osmosis that could be asked in a jam. The question here says, yam is used in this osmosis setup because, now notice the definition of osmosis. For most of us, osmosis is not just the movement of water from one region to the other. No, osmosis is the movement of water from one from one region to the other through a semi-permeable membrane. Osmosis is not just the movement of water, but the movement of water through a semi-permeable membrane. Water can move from anywhere, from your room to your parlor to whatever. But here, we're talking about it moving from a membrane, like it is trespassing a membrane. And the only thing that the yam is serving as here is as a semi-permeable membrane. Do you understand? So if you can see the wall of the V-shaped yam, you can see it is bordering the yam and the water inside the yam and the one inside the border. So the water has to cross through the yam. It's not like it's going to fly over. It's going to cross through. So the yam is acting as a semi-permeable membrane. Okay, let's check the other options as well so as to confirm our answer. The other option says it acts as a storage organ. It is not storing anything. We don't need it to store anything. Now, C here says it is permeable to the salt solution, which is false. No, it is permeable. It does not act as an organ that is permeable to salt solution. No. It only deals with water flow. So we're not talking about the salt solution in its entirety. The only thing that's moving through the yam membrane is just water from here to here. That's all. It's a plant material. We all know that. But here in this osmosis, the significance is that it is acting as a semi-permeable membrane. Do we understand? Okay, let's move on to the next one. All right, question 4. Now, the question says, which of the following results is to be expected if the setup is left for several hours? Now, we're talking about the setup of the yam, the salt solution, and the beaker. Now, if this setup is to be left for several hours, like I did it today, then we have to check upon it tomorrow. What's going to happen? Now, don't forget, I told you the other time, I told you that the salt solution in the beaker is concentrated. So water is going to be leaving the yam to the beaker, right? Now, if water is leaving the yam to the beaker, what will happen to the volume of the water in the yam? It's going to reduce. Do you understand? Whereas the water in the beaker is going to increase. Do you understand now? The water in the yam will reduce, water in the beaker will increase. So the question is, what is going to happen? Let's check the first option. The first option says, movement of water from the salt solution. Is water leaving the beaker to the yam? No. Water is leaving the yam to the beaker. So the first option is false. The second option says, decrease in the size of the yam. Now ask yourself a question. Does osmosis affect the size of the yam? They are not talking about the volume of the water. They are talking about the size of the yam. No, it does not affect it. That's no effect on it. So that's false. Movement of the salt solution into the water. Is the salt solution in the beaker going to be moving into the water of the yam? No. It is also wrong. So that's not our answer. Let's move on to the other one to see what the answer will be. The D says decrease in the volume of water inside the yam, which is correct. Because as water is leaving the yam, what will happen to the volume of the water inside the yam? It will be reducing. You are giving out, whereas you are not being replenished. So the water will be reducing constantly. Now, if the water in the yam is decreasing, it automatically means the water in the beaker will be what? Increasing. Because it is stealing water from the yam. So as it is stealing, it will be having more. Whereas the one we are stealing from will not have. So the yam will be reducing, whereas the beaker will be increasing. Do you understand? Okay, let's move on to question number 5. Alright, this question is infrequent, but it's better for you to know about it, you can say. Now the question says, the eggs of birds contain relatively larger quantities of yolk than those of amphibians and reptiles. The eggs of birds contains more yolk than the amphibians and reptiles, but let's first classify them. The birds are under caudata, and they are under a family known as the pyxis. No, I think, yeah, the aves, AVES. They are under AVES in particular. And we also have another class again under caudata. We have the amphibians and the reptiles. The amphibians are not weird. I think you've heard of them before. Amphibians, example of amphibians are toads. Do you understand? We have the toads, we have the frog. These are all amphibians. Do you understand me now? Okay, while talking about the reptiles, what about the rest of them? Can you give an example of the reptiles if you know any one of them? Okay, we have something like the lizard, right? So we have the lizard, we have the crocodile, anything that looks like the lizard, most of them are all reptiles. In fact, the snakes, I think they're also reptiles. Although, if you've heard of the story, they lost their leg, so their leg is not seen again. But anything that looks like a lizard, like alligator, they're all reptiles. So, and the amphibians, toads, frogs. Now, the eggs of birds now contains larger yolk than amphibians and reptiles because, before we go into the answer, what is the yolk? The yolk we are talking about here, we're talking about the yellow part of the egg. I think if you've broken egg before, you are going to see a white part and you are going to see a yellow part respectively, right? Now, the white part is also known as white part. It does not have a specific name or a special name, but the yellow part is known as the yolk. Now, it is in the region of this yellow part that the baby is going to be formed. But the essence of the yolk itself, the essence of the yolk, it's to serve as nutrition for the baby as it's developing. You know, unlike in humans, you know, we have what they call placenta that is feeding us from our mom to us. That's embryonic development. You understand? The placenta is collecting food from our mommy to us when we're inside our stomach. That's for humans. But in birds, they lay their eggs. There's no connection between the baby and the mother through anything like a cord or a tube or anything like us. There's no placenta for them. So they need a kind of source that will feed them until they are ready. So, and another thing to note is that in birds or animals that take longer period of development, their yolk is always bigger. Do you understand me? For example, someone that will last or that will use a whole year before they can be hatched, and somebody that will use maybe just a month before they can be hatched. Which one do you think we have more food in reserve? The one that will last a year, of course, because it will need longer period before it can develop. So it needs more food that will last the entire period, right? Now the same thing, birds take a lot of time to hatch entirely. They take a lot of time. I don't know the exact week, but they take a lot of time more than the amphibians and reptiles. The amphibians and reptiles, in fact, maybe especially the reptiles, they use just few weeks, 7, 8 or so. So between these amphibians and reptiles and the birds, which one do you think will be having more yolk? Of course, the birds, because they're taking longer time for development than the two of them. So let's check the answer. Let's start from D. Those of birds are fertilized internally? No. Birds are generally bigger in size? Still no, that's not the answer. Birds lay shelled eggs. Even lizards lay the same thing as well. So the answer here is embryonic development is longer in birds, so they need more yolk so that they can be fed. Do you understand? So the answer here is A. So that's the correct answer. If there's any contrary answer to this, you can also use the comment section. We are going to discuss how we got this. So, but the answer is A, and the reason is because birds take longer period of development than both amphibians and reptiles, and the function of yolk is to nourish the developing baby. So let's move on to the next question. So let's look at this question. It says mycorrhiza is an association between fungi and dash. Mycorrhiza is an association between fungi and dash. But before we go into that, I want us to first look at the meaning of mycorrhiza. Now, the word myco here means mycology. Myco here means mycology. Mycology is the study of fungi. Do you understand? So, questions like this, myco in jump, but first understand the meaning of what they are giving you. So, mycorrhiza, myco means fungi, and mycology means the study of fungi. Whereas the rhizae that is there, that's the RHIZA. The rhizae here means plant roots. Rhizae means plant roots. Mycology or the myco means fungi, and the rhizae means what? Plant roots, higher plant roots in particular. So now the question is now, mycorrhizae is an association between fungi, and what? So what would be your answer in this option after giving you this explanation? Obviously, the answer would be what? The roots of higher plants, because mycorrhizae is between fungi and plants, the root of plants. It is not a filamentous algae relationship, no. It is not bacteria, it is not protozoans. Now, another hint to this is this. I think we've all heard of leaching before. And leaching is the relationship between algae and one other organism. Because plants can both be organisms and animals as well. So, leaching is the relationship between algae and dash. I want you to provide us with the answer in the comment section. So, the answer here is roots of higher plants, because rhizome means roots and myco means fungi, not bacteria, not protozoans. So, let's move on to the next question. That's question number 7. Now, in question number 7, it says, if a nursing mother, this clinical question, damn, is very funny though, but this is a clinical question. If a nursing mother is not producing enough milk, her hormonal system is probably deficient in dash. For example, a woman, talking about a nursing mother is someone that's just giving birth. So if she just gave birth and the milk she's producing is not enough for the baby to be fed, in such cases, some people we want to buy milk, all this cutting milk, so that they can be feeding a baby, which is very, very wrong. But the question here is, if a nursing mother is not producing enough milk, our hormonal system is probably deficient in what? Talking about hormonal system, talking about the hormone. So what hormone is deficient? Now let's start from A. A says testosterone. Now testosterone is an hormone that's particularly found in males alone. It is not found in females. So let me gist you, the three hormones that are very important in male and female, testosterone is important, progesterone is important, estrogen is important. Among these three, testosterone is only found in males, and estrogen is only found in females. The only one that is common to both males and female is progesterone. The only hormone common to both male and female is progesterone. However, talking about testosterone, it's just to male, and estrogen is just to females. Now, the answer here is false. So testosterone does not have anything to do with milk, but it's found in males only. So that's enough to eliminate that option, because it's not even found in females. The other one says thyroxine. No, we are not concerned about thyroxine here. Thyroxine is also an hormone, but it's not concerned with milk production. So what exactly is the function of thyroxine? Thyroxine is an hormone that helps to promote growth in cells by helping the chemical reactions and also contributing to growth. It also controls growth in particular. Now, thyroxine contains iodine. Now, in some places, maybe in some villages or some modern places, which I'm not sure of, you see some people having a very big bulge at the front of their neck, a very big bulge. In Yoruba, they call it bebe or something. It's a very big bulge in front of their neck. That's because they lack thyroxine, or probably their body is deficient in iodine. So this thyroxine is very important in body growth, and that's why it's very important for you to use table salt, because I think most of them are iodized or something. So, but that's not still the answer. The answer is number C, says insulin. Now, is insulin the answer? No. We all know the function of insulin. Insulin helps to control the blood level and the blood sugar level, that is the amount of sugar in the blood. Now, it helps to convert glucose to glucagon. Glucagon is a storage form of glucose in the body. So automatically, insulin is not the answer, because it only deals with sugar. But the hormone we have here is prolactin, from the word lactate, prolactin. So prolactin is the exact hormone that is responsible, or that is helping milk production in the human female system. So the answer here is prolactin. Testosterone is only found in males, so it can be responsible. Thyroxine is for proper growth development, and insulin is for conversion or regulation of blood sugar level, whereas prolactin is for the milk production in the female. Okay, let's move on to the next question. The next question, number 8, says the type of joint found in the elbow is. The type of joint found in the elbow is. Now check your elbow, try and move it up and down. I'm not talking about your shoulder entirely, just the elbow. Try to like carry something up and down, staying at the same position. You notice that's what they call flexing and extension. So the type of joint that allows you to move your elbow forward and backward, do you think it will be ball and socket? No. Example of ball and socket joint is that in your shoulder. you notice that it's as if your shoulder is inside the ball. The same thing with your hip joint as well. Now, this is what they call ball and socket. Now, let's go to the next one. The next one says sliding joint. No, the only place you can find, or places where you can find sliding joint, is in places of foot joints. For example, or don't let us go deeper, but you can find sliding joints in foot joints, the metacarpal, phalangeal joints, etc. The tarsal joint as well. So that's not the answer. The suture joint, if you notice, there's a part of your brain. In fact, when a baby is small, there's a part of the brain that is always very prominent. When you touch it, you feel the heartbeat or the blood, the pulse of the blood there. Now, eventually, you notice as the baby grows up, that place is going to, the pulse is going to be reducing, and that place is going to close up. Now, the kind of joint that allows for the closure of the skull is known as the suture joint. Do you understand? The joint that allows for the closure of the skull, the bones in the skull, is the suture joint. And if this joint is not there, then a lot of babies will be dying because the brain can't be exposed for long. And that's why it is very important for you to take care of the head of a baby. That's because their joint are not yet closed up when they are small. So the suture joint is found in the brain. The sliding is found in leg regions. Ball and sockets in the hip joint and shoulder joint. But the hinge joint, allows for forward and backward movement. That's all. So the answer here is the hinge joint. Other places where you can find hinge joint is in the knee. Notice your knee. Your knee is also functioning like your elbow too. It can only move front and back. You can't move your knee left and right, no. Front and back, the same thing with the elbow. So you can find the hinge joint in the elbow. And the answer here is the hinge joint. Do you understand? So then let's move on to the next one, number 10. The question of number 10 says, the breakdown of fat and oils. The breakdown of fat and oils into simpler absorbable compound is catalyzed by the group of enzymes called, before going to the answer, we have several, I think 6 classes of food. We have the carbohydrates, we have the protein, we have the lipids, we have water, vitamins, etc. Now, the lipid component contains fats and oils. Do we understand? The lipid component contains fat and oil. The carbohydrate component contains what? Glucose. The protein component contains amino acid. But here we're talking about the fat and oil. And in some cases, the breakdown is fatty acids. But we're only concerned about these two. So fat and oils make up lipid. Now, the breakdown of lipid in general into simpler absorbable compounds, it is allowed, catalyzed, enabled by the group of enzymes called DASH. Let's take our answers. Peptidases, false. It is not a peptidase because peptidase deals with catalyzation of proteins. Remember, peptidase has to do with proteins. Now, if you've ever read protein, you know what they call peptide bonds. And peptide bonds are only found in proteins. So peptidases help to break those bonds. Amylases, if you remember the digestion of starch, it is very important in the conversion of starch to maltose, etc. So no, amylase is for carbohydrates, peptidase is for what? It's for protein. How about hydrolases? Even from the name, you can see for hydrolyzation. When you want to hydrolyze a compound, use hydrolases. That is wrong. But here you can see lipases. You don't need to cram this. Look at the name, lip. We talked about fats and oils to be lipid, right? So the correct answer here will be lipases. That is lipid enzymes. So lipases is the correct answer. They help in breaking down lipids into absorbable components. That's why you can swallow oil the way you like. And eventually, when you go to the toilet, you're not going to be seeing oil in your poo or anything. That's because these enzymes are there to help you break down lipids into simpler absorbable components. So let's do a little recap again. Peptidases deals with protein. Amylases deal with carbohydrates. Just remember peptide. Yeah. So peptidases deal with protein. Amylases, carbohydrates, lipases, lipids, hydrolases with hydrolyzation. Okay, so let's move on to the next question here. The process of pollination involves transfer of pollens from dash to dash. The process of pollination involves transfer of pollens from dash to dash. Now, pollination is very similar to sex in humans. In humans, you have to transfer the sperm from the male to the female. So the sperm is also known as pollens here. The sperm is also known as pollens. You understand? Now the male sex organ, which is penis, and the female, which is vagina, we also have the same thing similar to that implant. Implant, the male organ is anther. The female one is stigma. Let me repeat this again. The pollens is similar to sperm in humans, and it is always from the male. And the male sex organ, which is penis in humans, is also the same thing as anther. Whereas the female, which is vagina, is the same thing as the stigma. Don't mind my use of words or medicals. So these are things you should be exposed to normally. Anther means for the male, stigma means for the female. The style is just a kind of tube that is connecting the stigma. Filament, every other thing falls. Now let me ask you a question. Sperm, does sperm leave the male in humans to the female, or female to the male? Is sperm from the vagina to the penis, or from the penis to the vagina? Of course, it's going to be from the penis to the vagina. The same thing happens here. The sperm is being transferred from the anther, which is the male, to the female, which is stigma. So the process of pollination involves the transfer of pollens from the anther to the stigma. This is the correct answer. You don't need to think much about it. All right then, let's move on to the next one. Next one here says, the anaerobic fermentation. Anaerobic fermentation of a glucose molecule yields dash. Now, I don't think there's any argument about this. Talking about, we have types of respiration. We have the aerobic and the anaerobic. Talking about aerobic, if you remove this and, this is aerobic now. It's aerobic on its own. But if you put and, then it becomes anaerobic. Aerobic respiration has to do with the respiration that involves oxygen. It involves oxygen. Oxygen is needed. But in a situation whereby maybe an organism is in a place where oxygen is devoid, it has to still carry out respiration, right? Now, for example, bacteria, they use what they call anaerobic respiration because there's no oxygen. Now, in a situation whereby we have anaerobic fermentation, fermentation means increasing the concentration. For example, if for people who used to drink palm wine, if you leave palm wine overnight, it's going to ferment. The taste is going to become even more conk. That's what they call fermentation. Now, the anaerobic fermentation of a glucose molecule will yield dash. That is, the anaerobic respiration will yield what? Now, in aerobic respiration, remember, if you have to break glucose down by using oxygen, what are the things you are going to get? I want you to write the chemical formula on your notebook and give me the answer in the comment section. But I'm also going to tell you here, but I want you to try it on your own. If you aerobically break down glucose, that is, we combine C6H12O6 plus O2, we are going to be getting CO2 and water. Note, aerobic respiration or fermentation of glucose will give you water and CO2, or water and carbon dioxide. But in the absence of oxygen, which is anaerobic, anaerobic respiration or fermentation of glucose will only yield what we call two ATPs of ATP molecules and alcohol. That's all. Now, in our textbooks, they might write what they call ethanol. Ethanol and alcohol, they are also the same thing. Now, in aerobic respiration, the amount of energy molecules yielded is 38 ATP. Do we grab? 38 ATP is yielded in aerobic, but in anaerobic, it's just 2 ATP that is yielded and alcohol. In aerobic, we have 38 ATP, water and carbon dioxide. In anaerobic, we have 2 ATP and just alcohol, and that is the answer. So the answer here is 2 ATP and alcohol. So when you ask a question like this, if it is anaerobic, then look for the option that carries the smallest molecule, which is 2, and alcohol, then pick it as well. But if it is aerobic, then find the one that has the highest ATP molecules, which is 38. Do you understand now? Okay, let's move on to the next one. So the next question here says, the type of reproduction that is common to both Hydra and yeast is. Hydra and yeast is. Now let's check the first answer. I said grafting. I think you've heard of grafting before. Imagine cutting a watermelon tree or a branch of watermelon, then now bringing it in contact with orange tree. That's what they call grafting, cutting a part of a different species entirely and putting it with another species. Now sometimes they might be the same species but different traits. That's what they call grafting. Now that's not the answer. We have budding. Yes, the answer is budding. Hydra, when it's talking about budding, imagine a part of you growing, then suddenly that part of you that is growing, you cut it and you put it inside the floor and it's continuing with its growth. That's what they call budding. Like a part of you, it will cut off, then continue to grow on its own as a new baby. The same thing happens to Hydra. A part of Hydra will cut off and it will be growing. The same thing with yeast, a part of yeast will also cut off and be growing. Now, that's the answer. But let's check the other options too. Conjugation. Conjugation is a kind of sexual reproduction. It's also similar to sexual reproduction in general, where sperm and egg will mix together. But here, the things that are mixing together are different. Talking about conjugation, it means two things coming together in general. So conjugation is a sexual reproduction, and it's not both of them that carries it out. No. Now, the other one is binary fission and fission. Binary fission has to do with continuous division. And I think organisms that possess binary fissions are very small organisms. An example of that is bacteria. So it's not really common to the two of them. Binary fission is not really common to the two of them. It's only common to small organisms like bacteria and all those protozoans. They like undergoing binary fission. You can also find conjugation in, I think, paramecium. You can find conjugation in paramecium. You can find binary fission in bacteria. And you can find budding in both hydra and yeast. Grafting is also used for plants as well, not just for organisms. It's also used for plants. So, but the correct answer here is budding. They both bud off, that is, cut a part of them away, and that part will grow independently of them. So the answer is B. So the number 14 question here says, epigeal germination is of a seed is characterized by, we have two types of germination in general. We have the hypogeal and we have the epigeal, right? Now, in the hypogeal germination, the seed is not fully above the ground. The seed is not fully above the ground. So the only thing that grows faster in hypogeal germination is the epicotyl. The epicotyl means the head of the seed. There's also hypocotyl. Hypocotyl means the root of the seed. So in hypogeal germination, it is the epicotyl that rises above the floor, but it's not fully above the floor. But the epigeal, epigeal means completely above the floor level. That is otikuru ninu le, otijade wa ri dada kia kia. Now the reason why that will happen is because the hypocotyl grows rapidly. Now let me explain again. Look at your body. The first thing that grows faster in your body, if your leg grows faster, what will happen to your height entirely? You're going to grow taller, right? But if it is your neck that is growing taller, it's not going to have much effect on your height entirely. So the first thing that has to grow so that your height can be reasonable is the leg. And the leg is hypocotyl, whereas your neck is epicotyl. The same thing with plants. In epigeal germination, the hypocotyl, which is similar to our own leg, grows faster than the epicotyl, which is similar to our own neck. Do you understand? So the question here says that the characteristics of epigeal germination is what? Is it lack of growth of the hypocotyls? If your leg does not grow, will you grow taller? No. So the answer is false. More rapid elongation of hypocotyls than the epicotyls. That is, the leg is growing faster than the neck. They say more rapid elongation of the epicotyl than the hypocotyl. I told you that if the neck grows faster than the leg, that doesn't still increase your height. Equal rate of both epicotyl and hypocotyl. Does it really affect? No. So the answer here is more rapid elongation of the hypocotyls than the epicotyl. Now, I already gave you the hint to remember. Your hypocotyl is the leg, the epicotyl is the neck. If you want to have more significant height, your leg needs to grow faster than the neck. So the answer is hypocotyl faster than the epicotyl. Alright, so let's go to the next one. The next question says, all living cells require water because it. All living cells require water because it. Now, first ask yourself a question. Why do you drink water every time? Why do you need water? When you want to urinate, water comes out. When you are sweating, water comes out. If you lose too much water, you look thin, and etc. So water is very important in the body because of one major reason. The first one says, is a medium that neutralizes acid in cells. No, that's false. Water itself does not really act as a base. Although in most situations, it can act as a base, but not in the body. Most times, it even acts as an acid. So but here, we're not talking about the actions or functions of water, but it is not a medium that neutralizes acid. A medium that neutralizes acid is a basic medium. So remember the rules of neutralization. When acid and bases come together, they form salt and water. So it is a base that neutralizes acid, not the water there. The second one says, it is the main source of energy for cells. If that's the case, then that means I don't have to be eating. I just have to be drinking water and water and water every time so that it can give me energy. So obviously, it is not the main source of energy because that means you have to just be drinking water. And the next one says, prevent development of diseases in cell. Well, that can be true, but at this level, that is not so true. It doesn't have any real antibody function. So, although that does not mean you should not drink water. If you don't drink water, a lot of things are going to happen in the body, and you are going to be vulnerable to a lot of diseases. But it's not like it is the water that is doing the antibody functions. That's why we have the white blood cells there. So it does not prevent development of diseases in the cell. In fact, it might even give the disease an upper hand in developing faster. So because you did not drink water, does not mean you won't have malaria. And because you drink water does not mean you won't also have malaria. It does not have anything to do with antibodies or defense in the body. Now, the last one says it is a medium for all metabolic reactions. That is very true. Now, for any reaction, in fact, in chemistry, you need water. Whatever acid or base is given to you was first diluted with water. You can't prepare a solute without adding water to it in order to form a solution. So for you to form a solution, you need water. And the solution in most cases, and the solvent in most cases is always water. So water serves as a medium for all metabolic reactions. Glycolysis, Krebs cycle, all of them, they need water. Do you understand? So the correct answer is that all living cells require water because it is a medium for all metabolic reactions. So let's move on to the next one. Now, here we have the surface of an alveolus in mammals is well supplied with tiny blood vessels. The surface of an alveolus in mammals is well supplied with tiny blood vessels, known as. Before we go into that, what is an alveolus? You remember lungs. You know, we have lungs, we have alveoli. Alveoli are extensions, continuous extensions of the lungs. These are the ones that make contact with the body. You know, when the lung brings in oxygen, when you breathe in the oxygen and it goes to the lungs and everything, there are tiny extensions in that lungs known as the alveoli. These alveoli are the ones that are going to make contact with the blood system in the body and exchange oxygen and CO2. Do you understand? So the alveoli is just an extension of the lungs that helps to make contact with the blood system. So now they're asking us what part of the vessels of the body does it make contact with in particular. And I tell you, they are small like extensions. So you don't make any contact with anything to be with tiny blood vessels. And the only tiny blood vessels in your body is actually a tiny blood vessels. No, venous are tiny veins, but they are not in the region of the alveoli. Arterioles are not also there. So the only ones they can make contact with is the capillaries. The capillary is more like a junction between the arteries and the veins. So for impartiality, if we only supply to the arterioles, that means the only arterioles that will be receiving oxygen first. That means also the veins that will be receiving last. So as to make sure that everything is well equally distributed, we give it to the capillaries. Because the capillary is the bridge between the arteries and the veins, and it's going to be equally distributed between them. So the tiny blood vessels in the body automatically is the capillaries. So that's the answer for this. Now, the next question says, nervous control differs from hormonal control. Nervous control differs from hormonal control. Now, the first thing you have to ask yourself is, what is nervous control? Now, nervous control is, it has to do with impulse, stimuli, that's nervous system. So for example, when you touch your leg, maybe you mistakenly mashed a nail or maybe a glass or something. Well, in the next few moments, maybe a few milliseconds, you notice that yourself, you just remove the leg automatically. Or let me say you are stepping on a very hot platform. What will happen? You remove your leg quick. That's what they call a nervous control. It deals with stimuli. In fact, you might not even have control over it in all cases. You touch a spoon that is very hot. Maybe you are cooking. You forgot the spoon inside the pot. Then you want to touch the spoon so as to turn it. The moment you touch it, you notice that you release the spoon quick because it's very hot. That's nervous control. But talking about hormonal control, I think we've talked about that before. We're talking about prolactin, testosterone, etc. So they say, what is the difference between these two? And they use the word former. In exam, if they use the word former means for the first one mentioned. That's the nervous. If they use latter in, let me type it out so you can see it. Latter is L-A-T-T-E-R. If they use the word latter has to do with the last one mentioned. Former has to do with the former, and the latter means the last one. So, but they say nervous differs from hormonal in that the former this time around, is a slower process. Is that true? No. Nervous is very fast. That's why you're able to respond quickly by removing your leg from a hot spoon or whatever. It involves only chemical transmission. That's false. Chemical transmission has to do with hormonal control in particular. Has no specific pathway. That is very, very, very false. They have specific pathway. That's why we have neurons. Neurons means nerve cells. Axons, dendrites, etc. They produce short-term changes. Yes, that is true. So the answer is D, because nervous controls, they produce short-term changes. Remember, if you match a very hot something on the floor and you remove your leg, are you going to keep removing your leg till eternity? No, it's just for that moment, just a response, and it is electrical response. So the first one says it's a slower process. No, it's very fast. It involves chemical transmission. No, it is electrical transmission.
It has no specific pathway. No, they have axons, dendrites, neurons in particular. They produce short-term changes. True. The changes are just for a moment, whereas for hormonal control, the changes last often a while. So that was the answer about this. So the next question says, identical twins inherit their genes from identical twins, at least they have common features, they look almost the same way, they speak almost the same way. You see all these twins that wear the same thing together. Talking about identical twins, they have a lot of things in common. Now they are saying they have or they inherit their own genes from one. Now before we go into that, twins can be formed in two ways, monozygotic and dizygotic. Now, all dizygotic are never identical. Talking about dizygotic, it means two eggs and one sperm. Dizygotic means two eggs and one sperm. An example of that is option B. And I told you that dizygotics are never identical. So when you have two eggs and a sperm, they are different entirely. So which means they can never be identical. So option B is out of the case here. Monozygotic can be in three ways, but the important one for this level is this. Monozygotic involves just one egg and one sperm. One egg and one sperm, and they might divide in different stages of their life. Now, another type of twins you must know are the twins that can be formed from two sperms and one egg. Now, the possibility is very low, but it has been proven at least once or twice. So, at this level, you don't know about it, but an egg can be fertilized by two different sperms. It's very, 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 very rare. But identical twins can only come from one egg and one sperm. So let's see the options. Option A says one egg and two sperms. Like I told you, it is possible, but it wants to give them identical stuff or anything, and they rarely survive. But B says two eggs and a sperm. That is dizygotic, like I told you, and it's never identical. And C says the same egg and sperm. The same egg and sperm. D says different eggs and sperm. So between C and D, which one do you think would be the correct answer? What do you think? Of course, the C. The same egg and sperm will give identical. If it's different eggs and sperm, they can never be identical. So the answer here is what? C. Do you understand? So let's move on to the next question. So the next question says, paternity disputes can most accurately be resolved through the use of dash. Talking about paternity dispute, we're talking about father. Maybe you want to confirm who is the father of this boy, who is the father of this and that and this and this. That's what they call paternity dispute. If it is maternity, it means who is the mother. Maternity means mother, paternity means father. So we want to determine, maybe there's a problem. A father is complaining that the baby they have in the family is not his own. Maybe the mother have gone out to cheat and they want to truly confirm. Then which of these can be used to accurately do that? Let's start from the last one. The last one says blood group typing. Now, if you have to use blood group, that would be almost impossible. For example, there are millions of people in the world that have O group, O blood group. For example, I have O positive, some might have O negative, this and that. So if the baby is having O and the father is also having O, that's not a proof that the baby is for the father. Because if that is a proof, that means the baby can also be my own because I'm also O positive. You understand? So we can't use blood group typing because blood group is very common. Tongue rolling, if you've blood discontinuous and continuous variation. Tongue rolling is also a property. It's not continuous, it's a discontinuous variation. So, because your baby can roll the tongue and you too can roll the tongue does not mean you are the father or maybe it's the son or daughter or whatever. A lot of people in the world can also tongue grow and that doesn't prove anything at all. Now, fingerprints. You see, there are different types of, or let me say patterns of fingerprints, but I think three or four major. We have the holes, the arc, the loop, and one that one I don't remember. However, in this world, no one ever has the same fingerprint. Now, although I might have walls, you should have walls too, but our walls will never look the same. That's why when you want to register for Jamb, you notice that you're using your thumb to do fingerprint. And nobody else among the 1.6 or 1.8 million registrants will have similar fingerprint pattern to you. Or else, when you want to log in your portal on the day of exam, you won't be able to log in. So, in the entire world, as much as we are almost 7 billion or 8 billion, nobody has the same fingerprint, unless by mistake. Or maybe there's a sensory problem. So, which means, if everyone does not have the same fingerprint, it means your father is not going to be having the same thing with you, even if the person is your father. Your mother is not going to be having the same fingerprint as you. Because you are both related genetically, does not mean you are going to be having the same fingerprint. No. Fingerprints are determined phenotypically, not by genotype or whatever. It is determined phenotypically. So, which means B is not the answer. Anybody or everybody has different fingerprints. Tongue rolling, anybody can have it. Blood group, anybody can have it. But the best answer here is the DNA analysis, one of the most expensive ways to check for the DNA of a baby and its compatibility with the parents. So this DNA analysis, remember in reproduction, when sperm and egg meet and fuse together, they exchange genes and chromosomes comes together, they merge, a lot of things happen. Now, the basis of everything is the DNA. The DNA allows for the storage of information that can be passed on to the next baby, to the next generation. So whatever your father has been passed on to you. And the only way you can check it is through DNA analysis. So DNA analysis is going to show you the information of the father in the daughter or the son. Now, if the DNA analysis of the father is not in the gene of the baby, that means the baby does not belong to the father. But if it is there, then that means the baby belongs to the father. And note, nobody can frame DNA analysis. It's not possible for you not to be a father of someone and you'll be finding the information of that person in the baby's DNA. No, it's very impossible. You have to be the father before you can see the DNA. The reason is because the baby is just a joint formation from both the father and the mother, which means both of them contributed different information into the baby. It's just as if you're merging 1 + 1 to form 1 again. So different information is contained from the father and from the mother, and they are all deposited into the baby. So DNA analysis helps to resolve paternity disputes, and it is one of the most expensive processes you can go through to solve any dispute in your family. So the last one for today in this video is 20. Although we still have more, but we're not going to be doing that today. In the next video, we're going to also continue the rest. Now, number 20 says sex-linked genes are located on. So first, let's define what is a sex-linked gene. Sex-linked genes are genes that are present on the sex chromosomes. In humans, we have 46 chromosomes. So, and out of these 46, two of them is known as sex chromosome. That is the X and Y. So for example, for a male like me or you, you will be having 46XY. That is 46XY. It means you have two sex chromosomes, X and Y. In females, they'll be having 46XX. That is two X chromosomes. So males have XY, females have XX. Now, any gene that links to this XX or XY is known as sex-linked genes. The genes that are linked to the X and Y chromosomes are known as what? Sex-linked genes. And sex chromosomes are X and Y, and they are just two. Now, the remaining 44 chromosomes, which are not sex chromosomes, they are called autosomes. Chromosomes that are not sex chromosomes are known as autosomes. Do we understand now? So, sex-linked genes are located on, let's start from D, on Y chromosome. It is not only on Y chromosome, so we can't pick that. On X chromosomes, it is not only on X chromosome, so we can't pick that. Homologous chromosomes. Homologous chromosomes can be also autosomes. We have 44 autosomes, so any one of them can be homologous. So we are not interested in that. That is the false answer. And it says X and Y chromosomes, which is correct. Like I told you, sex-linked genes are genes found on sex chromosomes, which are X and Y. So that is all for today's tutorial. And these are all extracts of Jamb past question, which we have taken our time to sort out the correct answers and the explanation for you. So if there's any confusion about the questions we've solved, please use the comment section and let us know. In the next video, we are going to continue this biology. We are going to extract some questions again that are similar or mostly repeated. Now, I want you to go over this video again, write out all the topics that we solved the questions on or from, and read related content to them. Most of these are always repeated, and you can never do your jam without seeing few of these questions in them. Though they might not come the same way, but they always come in a related way. For example, when talking about the continuous variation and discontinuous variation, they might ask you, is tongue rolling a continuous variation or discontinuous? And they might not. They might ask you another different thing. So try and ensure that you go through the topics relating to these questions and find the contents that are reasonable from them. So also, if you want us to make a video on a particular question or a particular subject, please make use of the comment section. If you have any question for us too, it's all appreciated. In our next video, like I said, we are going to be continuing our biology. Now, for those who need physics and chemistry, please let us know in the comment section as well. We'll be glad to help. So I hope you have subscribed to our channel. Click on the notification bell so as to receive more notifications from us. And I appreciate you for watching this video. Success is yours. Thanks for watching.